when somebody breaches an agreement with you, or what happens if you breach an agreement with someone else? What are their rights and what are your obligations? And so we talked about before that there are four broad categories of damage. What are they? The first one is what? Compensatory damage, right? The second one is what? Consequential damages, and that goes to cover what? Cover what? Indirect and what? And foreseeable, right? Damages that you reasonably could foresee would come out of, again, a breach. So if, for example, you had an agreement to drive somebody to the airport, if you're an Uber driver, and you got there and they relied upon you, you had an agreement to pick them up, and they got there so late they missed their airplane, and that caused them to basically and you knew that they had to actually get there because they were going to be singing at a concert, and they missed their airplane. They told you that they were going to be going to the concert. They missed their airplane, and you were late as a result. You didn't give them notice, and you could have given them notice that you were running late, but you didn't. And as a result, again, they again missed this concert, and they therefore their contract was canceled. They could try to again sue you because it was what? Their damages was what? Were what? Especially if you knew about it. You knew about that they had to be there on time. You knew that they had this contract. And you didn't take, again, the steps to prevent them from being late, even though you could have just basically called them and told them that you were running behind and they should get another driver. What could they do to you? Sue you for what? What consequential damages? Because those damages were what? Reasonably foreseeable. And that's what you want to do. Now, again, key point to recognize, if the chain of events are so far removed from the actual event itself. So if your breach, basically, so I gave you about three different items. So one, it's likely that if you missed your plane, and the person knew that you had to be there on time, that right there could probably be reasonably foreseeable. However, if particularly the person who's driving you had no clue about what you were doing after the plane, but just knew that they had to get you to the plane, but then again, by you missing the plane, you then missed your interview to basically get a job, and you did not get that job. If you tried to again sue that person for that damage, it would likely be declared that that was not reasonably foreseeable, and that that person again could not be held liable for that because the chain of events was so far removed to be reasonably foreseeable. So again, what you want to think of is what should a reasonable person be responsible for, all right? The third is the what? Damage. Punitive damage. And that's done to do what, Ms. Green?
Punish,
right? Punish and what else?
Deter,
right? So again, to punish somebody from doing something, and also to deter him or other people around him from doing the same, right? The third is what? The fourth is what?
Nominal.
And nominal could be as little as what?
$1.
Exactly. An example of is that Katy Perry or Taylor Swift? Exactly, right? So those are the things that we've gone over already. Now, one thing I wanted to discuss is the issue of compensatory damages, right? It's a nice formula that I think you should get, right? So again, we talked about the value of performance as promised, right? Then you have the value that the performance was actually rendered. Minus, so again, damages that you can collect is the value of the performance. So for example, if you had a contract and the contract was worth $1,000, you would have to subtract, again, anything that they did to deliver on that, even though they breached. So let's say, for example, if they only performed half of the work that you, again, asked them to perform, right, which is worth $1,000. So then you subtract that performance value, which is 500. And then let's say, for example, if the, as a result of the contract being avoided, you are able to essentially do it yourself. And so you essentially did essentially about $200 worth of the contract. You didn't have to pay anybody, you did it yourself. It might be, you didn't have a loss in that instance, it could be argued. And then therefore, would have to subtract that, right? Or let's say, for example, if you didn't do it yourself, but as a result of them, you know, basically giving you heads up they couldn't do it, you didn't, as it turned out, you didn't need, you know, because they did it in so such a timely manner that instead of you needing the entire $1,000 worth of services, you only needed, $700 worth of those services. And in that case, because again, they mitigated your loss, you would then not be able to recover for the extra, for the entire $1,000 only. How much? You wouldn't be able to recover for the entire $1,000 because they, again, saved you $300. So how much could you recover from? $700, exactly. So that would, again, be subtracting, again, the value of any loss avoided. Plus, so you subtract two things that were reduced from that contract. However, then you can add on incidental value damage, and then incidental or what did we decide? We discussed before. Incidental or what? Incidental value is what? What is incidental value? Incidental value. I said incidental damages. What is incidental damages? Expenses or costs that are caused by the breach of contract, such as the, again, costs incurred obtaining performance from another source. So we know consequential damages are those that were, again, reasonably foreseeable were the consequential damages. But the incidental damages are those that, again, directly, those direct costs that arise from the breach. So again, if in this last scenario we said that somebody was supposed to be performing some services for you, they didn't perform the services, you were able to, again, because they notified you, you were able to take some actions that prevented you from having, again, the total loss, but they provided you, again, half of it. You then, the steps you had to take, though, in order to, again, prevent yourself from experiencing the total loss, required you to get somebody else to do it, right? Somebody else had to come and do it. Or even if you did it, then any expenses that you incurred to actually do that work yourself, and maybe even your own labor, that would fall under incidental damages.
820.
Thank you. So then you add that on to the thing. So again, let's say, for example, you have $1,000, you got only $500 worth of services from the contractor before they breached. Then on top of that, you were able to actually do some of the work, or you had somebody else do some work because they let you know that they weren't going to be able to do it fully. So you save yourself from having to again, experienced the entire $1,000 worth of loss. So let's say, for example, as I said before, they did 300, that you were able to, again, avoid $300 worth of that loss. So again, we said that the loss in that instance was, we said, 700, right? So we had $700 worth of loss. $500 they didn't, I'm sorry, $500 they did. Then they also did, again, they avoided you having to realize $200 worth of expenses. So in that instance, you have 1,000 minus 500 is how much?
500
minus 200 is how much?
300.
So that's the 300 is, at that point, is the value of your damages. However, because you had to actually spend yourself another $300, how much are your damages now? 300 plus 300, right? 600. Exactly. So that's the thing, that's the way to calculate. So again, this is an important calculation for you, important formula that you probably will see again. So I would encourage you to, again, take note of that, all right? Now we're going to look at, we talked about before how to concentrate another form of contract or calculating compensatory damages is to look at the differences between the contract price and the fair market value, right? And before we had a formula, we said that the compensatory damages is equal to the contract price minus the fair market value. But when we went through it again, we said the actual formula was contract price was compensatory damages is equal to the market price minus the contract. All right, and that was key as we discussed with those servers. All right, so now we're talking about again construction contracts, and in construction contracts, there are various remedies available based upon when the contract was breached, as well as based upon the actual party for breaching the contract, all right? So let's go to you, Mr. Hassan. If you, Mr. Hassan, let's go to you. So if you hired Ms. Hodge, you hired Ms. Hodge to work on your house. She was your, interior designer, right? You got a new house out here in Prince George's County. You said, you know, you made a lot of money. What is it that you want to do after graduation?
Be an accountant.
So you're an accountant. You have your own accounting firm. You're doing extremely well, you know, and you're raking in, you know, millions of dollars in accounting contracts, and you hire Ms. Hodge, because Ms. Hodge, what do you want to do after you graduate? So one of the things, the company that she has come up is, again, an interior design company, right? And so you said, hey, I got this beautiful house out here near your Bowie State. You know, they finally developed this area, so there's a bunch of trees, it's not now nice, you know, town complex. And I wanna have you, Ms. Hodge, because you're, you know, one of my classmates. I wanna have you come to my house and actually just totally hook it up. You know, I want the best looking house that I've ever, you know, seen, better than any of the other houses, right? So he goes and asks you, Ms. Hodge, to give him a proposal. Right? Submit a bid for how much it's gonna cost for you to make my house look fabulous, right? And so you submit a proposal and say, okay, well, it's going to cost in terms of the actual, you know, goods and equipment and all materials that I'll have to have my people buy is going to cost you, let's say, $40,000 for
for the things. In fact, let's say since it's a beautiful, let's just say $150,000. Materials worth $150,000. That's and a material and my services, and that includes materials as well as the labor for the people actually working. But for my services as your consultant, you're gonna have to pay me on top of that, let's say an additional $30,000, right? So it's how much is that contract? $180,000, all right? So again, if you then, so my question to you is that before Miss Hodge actually starts working on your house, right? Before Miss Hodge starts working in your house, and she, you give her a call and say, you know, Miss Hodge, I talked it over with my wife, and she doesn't want to do this anymore. You know, I thought I was gonna make her happy. You know, hook this house up. You know, the housewives of Potomac or something like that. She doesn't want to do that. We want to just, you know, have something more modest. So we're not going to, you know, hire an interior designer to come in here and renovate our entire house and do some of the things that we discussed. So I don't need your services. At that point, what are you obligated to pay Ms. Hodge?
The total contract price minus the cost of materials and labor, even though we didn't start the performance yet.
So again, in this case, as I said before, the materials, let's say that the materials and labor cost was, as I said, how much? I said it's $150,000. Right? 150. So in this case, what are you obligated to pay her?
$30,000.
30. Again, the contract price minus the materials and labor. So in this case, she didn't have to buy, right, the materials and labor. However, she is going to be out of what? Her profit. In that case, her profit was how much?
$30,000.
So you are entitled, or she's entitled, to $30,000, right? Another scenario. Let's say for, you can have a seat. Ms. Green. Ms. Green, another scenario. So she starts working on this beautiful house. Now, what do you want to do after you graduate?
Financial analysis.
You want to be a financial analyst. So let's say now you're working for one of the big Wall Street companies, and you're on you're a commentator and an analyst that comes on CNBC. Talks about the various markets that you're tracking, let's say the technology market, and you've come up after working for Best Buy, and you know all the technology that there is because you've been tracking them all throughout, you know, your college career, and now, you know, you are an analyst after getting your MBA, and you are following any of these companies and all their movements, and so you've now hired, again, Ms. Hodge to, you know, renovate your home with her interior design and renovation company. And while she starts working, your husband comes home, and he is tired of having his house all just totally, you know, messed up with all these contractors coming in and out the house, and, you know, the children are, you know, basically, you know, all cranky because they get to bed late, and the whole family is just in disarray, and he says, look, I just want this to stop right now. Get this. You know what I mean? We're going to just, you know, I want all these people out of my house right now, you know, just patch up whatever you're doing and just, you know, leave now. We're going to just, you know, maybe put this thing on a shelf and I have to come back to it. And you're like, what are you talking about? We've already, you know, we've already gotten in this contract with Ms. Hodge, because if we
ate them,
thank you, if we throw them out now, we'll have to pay what?
You have to pay them the cost of, the retail budget.
You have to pay them what, Ms. Green? What would you tell your husband if we stop this work right now? I know you're frustrated, but if we stop this work right now, what do we have to pay Ms. Hodge and her firm? So let's say, again, in this scenario, you know that, again, Ms. Hodge has said that it's going to cost you, in terms of labor and materials, $150,000, right?
Yeah.
They're halfway through that project. Halfway through the project, right? So, again, what's the first cost you know off the bat? And then her profit was how much?
$30,000.
Right? So, in this case, how much off the bat do you know? You tell your husband, off the bat, honey, we're going to have to pay how much?
$180,000.
No, we said off the bat, you have to pay what?
$30,000. Yeah.
All right? Babe, I know you sick and tired, but know that at minimum, we're talking about what?
$30,000. Yeah.
On top of that, they have worked halfway through this job. The job, again, materials and labor, is how much?
$150,000.
So on top of that $30,000, how much else do you gonna have to pay, love? I'm asked, half of that is what?
$75,000.
So the total amount that that the family's about to kick out?
Is
$105,000. So you say, babe, is it worth it? That's the question you have to ask yourself. I know you're sick and tired of all this stuff going on in our house, but is it worth $105,000? $105,000, you know, I know I'm bringing some bacon into the house, but that's going to be a setback. Right? On top of that, we're going to have to hire some other people down the road to finish this work. So the question is it worth it? And that's what you have to tell them. Have to have a real conversation. Is it worth $105,000 worth of part of it? All right? Now, let's say this. Let's say another scenario. In this same scenario, Miss Hodge has finished the work. And you guys look up, you know, and although she's actually, in the beginning, she shows you the pictures of how the house was gonna look, right? And now the house looks exactly like she said it's gonna look. The pictures and what the house looks like, it's almost the same. And then your husband says to you, "Now, I actually don't like this actually at all anyway. And this wasn't even what I wanted. We waited all this time and went through all this heartache. And, you know, I'm not even happy with this. We're not paying her anything. Nothing. I don't like this at all." Right? So then you go to the TEC law firm. Right? Call us and say, "Professor Kareem, we got this deal. We're trying to, you know, basically, you know, get out of our obligation to our contract, Ms. Hodge." You remember Ms. Hodge? She was sat right next to me in class. I'm like, "Oh, yeah, I remember her." "So what's she doing now?" "She's a interior designer. She's just blowing up all the magazines. I hired her." What would I tell you that you're obligated to pay her at that point?
The entire contract plus interest.
Exactly. You're entitled. So not only, again, are you obligated to pay her, and the contract price was how much?
$180,000.
Right? $180,000 was the contract price. Not only do you have to do that, but the more you delay, the
the more you what? The more you pay, right? Because interest is added on a daily compounded manner, right? So this is not like 10% today, 10% tomorrow, 10%. It's actually 10% calculating, again, an arithmetic formula on top of that. So it just, again, compounds. So I would say to you and your husband, why, understand that you are perhaps not as pleased because the pictures, right, are almost identical, in fact, are identical to what actually she said she was going to do in your house, right? The designs that she came up with almost identical to what she said they would look like. You don't have a case. So the best thing you can do is to pay when? Today.
Yeah.
Don't avoid. Pay her right away. Right? Save yourself some money. In fact, I'm not even going to charge you for that consultation. Go ahead. All right? Save yourself $450 off of that. All right? To make sure you don't do it again. All right? That's what's going to happen. Okay? So those are things that now, let's give another survey. You have a seat. Let's go now to you, Miss Kayla Hall. Now, let's say, for example, in this instance, same scenario with Ms. Hodge. She, before she starts working on your house, what do you want to do after you graduate?
Open my assistant living home.
Okay, assistant living home. Let's say, in this case, you have now... building a chain of assisted living homes. Like, have you ever heard of Covenant House? Mm-hmm. Ever heard of Covenant House? Covenant House is it's like a community, assisted living community, in Silver Spring. I think they have one in Bethesda. And so you hire, again, Ms. Hodge's firm to come in and actually help you to design your assisted living homes, right? Mm-hmm. And so she normally, again, caters to people's doing people's homes, right? But she, you used to sit with her in class, you contacted her, you said, hey, I'm doing this, really beautiful assisted living community. Would you be interested in coming out? She said, cool, I really don't normally do that, but yeah, I'd be interested. She comes out, she agrees to, that the contract in terms of the labor in this instance is going to be about $1 million. $1 million worth of materials and labor, right? Mm-hmm. And then her profit on this is going to be, $200,000. $200,000 is her profit, and $1 million is actually the materials and labor. And so in that case, the total contract price is what? Total contract price in that case, Ms. Hall, is what?
$1.2 million,
right? So in this instance, let's say, for example, if she calls you again before she actually starts working, you guys have been talking, she's giving you the bid, you accepted the bid, you signed the contract, and 2 weeks after that process, she calls you and says, you know what, I just got a opportunity to design the house for the next number one draft pick for the Washington Wizards, and it's gonna basically put me on a whole nother level in terms of my work, and I can't afford to do your job because it's just this one right here is just gonna take me to the next level. What would you tell her that she's gonna have to pay you if she breaches your contract? So again, in this instance, she hasn't started the work, mm-hmm. right, for you. The total contract is $1.2 million. And let's say, for example, when you tell her that if I have to find somebody else, right? Mm-hmm. You're going to have to pay me what?
$200,000.
How'd you come up with $200,000?
$1.2 million, because that was the
The contract price is 1.2. So, again, where did you come up with this $200,000? You're gonna tell her that if I have to find somebody else, what? If I have to find somebody else, what, Miss Murray? If I have to find somebody else, you're gonna have to pay what? Miss Murray?
Stepped out.
Okay. Mr. Ocean Rookboy? And so you're gonna have to pay. You said what?
The delay of performance.
The what?
The cost of compensation.
So what does that mean?
Basically, the remainder of not that you didn't complete for the next contract.
What does that mean? You think, Ms. Hall?
What do you think?
What'd you say?
The cost of compensation?
Yeah. The cost of compensation to who?
Me.
You are the owner.
Okay, so did
you. You're the owner. You tell Ms. Hyde, look, if you breach this contract, right, even though you haven't started the job, you haven't spent one penny on the job, right? However, if I have to hire somebody else to do this work, what is it that they're going to have to pay you? What is it that she's going to have to pay you?
The cost for the other person. The other person's
profit. Is the other person's profit? Mr. Ocean Rogue Boy, what is it related to the other person?
Labor.
The other person's labor?
No.
What is it, Ms. Hodge? Their compensation that what? It's the, you said what is it, Ms. Hyde? That is what? That is what? Who?
So they have a form. Exhibit 19.1.
Is that let me see, Ms. Hyde doesn't have it. Ms. Murray. If you want to hear, you probably hear the scenario. Mr. Parks. Mr. Parks.
Yeah.
What is it that you that she's gonna have to pay?
I don't know either.
Ms. Sinead. Ms. Hodge said some of it. She said the compensation. Compensation that what? Again, these are math problems. That's why we talked about the other day. This math is important. In terms of contract law, math is everything.
The cost is
gonna, Mr. Willis.
The cost of her finding someone else to do the...
the cost of somebody else that what?
Is going to come in and do the work.
So again, the contract price is $1.2 million. She's going to have to pay how much?
The cost of her going out to find someone else to do it.
The cost of going out to find somebody else to do it.
Right?
Huh?
It's the other person's profit.
Well, let's say the other person, again, has the same profit.
Then it's
$200,000. No. It's the same profit, right?
Uh-huh.
$200,000, huh?
Plus anything
over. So let's say for this person's profit is still $200,000, so it's not necessarily a profit. It could be, again, excess materials and labor, right? So again, this person, it's not going to cost them $1 million. It's going to cost them 1.2. The cost and materials are going to cost them 1.2. The other, their profit is still $200,000. Or this is going to cost them, instead of $1 million, it's going to cost them $2 million. Right? Do the same work.
$845.
That,
probably, again, there's a little bit off, again, but it's going to cost them double, then that might be, again, you might have a hard time. Let's say, again, it was going to cost them $100 instead of $1 million, $1.1 million, or $1.2 million, or $1.3 million, which is reasonable, right? Mm-hmm. Then if it's going to cost them $1.3 million to do the same job, that, again, she was going to do for $1.2 million, then, again, you would have to tell her, Ms. Hall, you would have to, again, tell Ms. Hodge that what she's going to have to pay you is what?
100.
Oh, Ms. Hall.
The 100 more. 100,
exactly, 100,000 more. So if she breaches your contract, you're going to tell her, because I'm going to have to go and actually, you're going to say, I've called around, and I've found that the only person who can do this is, again, Mr. Parks' firm. And Mr. Parks is going to charge me 1.3. You are charging me 1.2. So therefore, you're going to have to pay me how much, Ms. Hall?
$100,000.
That's how we calculate those damages, all right? Yes, I'll see you. Let's now go to another one. Let's go, that was Ms. Hall, right?
Right, I'm confused. What, you said, what amount you don't have to pay the $200,000?
You don't have to pay, again, you didn't have to pay she did not start work. You didn't start work on the job, right? So you didn't incur any expenses at all. However, because she had to go in, as he said before, find somebody else to do the job, and that was going to cost her an additional $100,000, because they were going to charge her not 1.2, they were going to charge her 1.3.
So you just pay for whatever.
So whatever's over. Okay. That's it. Yes, ma'am.
So it's not the same as the first one where if he didn't start the job, remember, like, he talked to his wife.
Mm-hmm.
And his wife is like, no. But
right.
You still have to pay her $30.
Exactly. It's a reverse, because it's a breach of contract. Again, that's what you have to understand, who's breaching.
Okay.
Right. It was the owner was breaching in the first instance. Now it's the contractor breaching. That's the key issue.
So you don't have to pay for any of the labor?
Because no, none of the labor, you didn't start the job. You didn't start the job. It's not the issue of delay, it's the issue of whatever it's going to cost you over and above, again, the contract price, right?
Yeah.
Now, let's say, for example, the same scenario, Ms. Murray, same scenario, right? Oh, I'm sorry, go back to Ms. Hodge. Ms. Hodge, let's ask you. Ms. Hodge? Same scenario, you, again, are the contractor here, and you decide that you're going to, again, you got an opportunity to, this case, President Obama has contacted you and said that he wants to build a White House. He's going to move back to Chicago, and in order to help, you know, stimulate the economy down there in Chicago, because all these people killing each other because they don't have any job, he wants to hire a lot of people to build this new, instead of instead of living in the White House, he wants to build the Ebony House in Chicago, and he wants you to come down to help him to build Ebony House in Chicago. However, you know that you have a contract with Ms. Hall that's worth $1.2 million, right? And you have started, performing that contract. You're halfway through that $1.2 million in work. So half of $1.2, again, is where you're into. If he asked you to come and you said 850.
Yeah.
If he asked you to come and work for him, what are you going to tell him he's going to have to pay you, because you're going to have to owe Ms. Hall how much? Huh?
You said I already started working, right?
Halfway through the $1.2 million. Huh? Right, you said 5.1? So it's gonna be, again, $510,000, right?
Yeah.
That's how much, again, it's not really just the halfway, it's gonna be all the costs incurred by the owner to complete the job. So if she goes and says again that the other person that is going to take over the job is gonna do it for 1.3, then you're gonna have to tell President Obama that he's gonna have to pay you how much? Have a what?
1.2.
No. Your contract